false prophet is to be clear from time to time that Nigeria's problems should be blamed on a failure of political leadership. Of course, a leader who is greedy will be corrupt and is bound to fail with leadership responsibility. But ladies and gentlemen, we ought to understand that leadership does not exist only at the top of the governance system. Leadership is essential everywhere, beginning with the family and going all the way through institutions, systems, associations, and all other places where we work together to achieve certain ends. If we look closely, we realize that leadership is necessary in every place where some responsibility or the other will be carried out. If we had good leadership performance in every family, would we not enjoy responsible and effective governance performance in the nation? Leaders are also great people. Custodians, not only of our material fortunes, but more importantly, guardians of our values and standards. The governor of Niger State describes himself as chief servant, reminding himself constantly that his true role is to facilitate his people's access to the opportunities that the state offers them. When a greedy governor becomes only a possessor at the gate of opportunity, he may siphon funds from the state treasury, transfer the money to accounts in a foreign land. His gatekeeping misdemeanor not only deprives his people of their fortune, it enriches the economy of another nation while compounding the poverty in his own territory of responsibility. When a parent or guardian starves his child or ward of the training in values that can best happen in the family setting, it's condemning the young person to a future of instability, where exposure to low-quality influence may turn him into a cultist, a drug user, or some other kind of criminal. When a teacher at the highest level of our educational system, employs a method of knowledge sharing that ignores the need to stimulate the student's curiosity and powers of idea generation, failing in his duty to hold open the gates of opportunity for his children's future development. I say to we all fail woefully if we continue to run a system of governance that distorts the structure of preparing and rewarding the gatekeepers in our nation. Let us examine some outcomes of present policies and practices in Nigeria. Doctors, teachers, and other professionals achieve lower take-home pay than members of the National Assembly who are on part-time employment during the year. Do we truly believe that someone who, under our current system, comes into possession of a seat in the Legislative House is worth more to the good health and stable future of this nation than a teacher, a judge, a medical doctor, or a head of national security? Speaking a few days ago, the president of the Nigerian Medical Association said that he has access to records that show that Nigerian citizens going to India for medical treatment spend about $500 million annually this medical tourism. And I wonder how much it will cost our gatekeepers to open the gates of home-based opportunity by creating medical facilities of the correct standard right here in Nigeria. In a lecture delivered only a week ago in the Bokuta, a senator quoted the chairman of the Committee of Pro Chancellors of Nigerian universities are saying that 75,000 Nigerians studying in Ghana spend about 160 billion naira yearly, approximately 80% of the total budget of 33 federal universities in Nigeria in 2010. Perhaps we feel comfortable with the even larger volumes of funds that our students utilize in Europe and United States. But to think that the gatekeepers of opportunity in Ghana are beating us at the game. We are already familiar with the fact that thousands of Nigerian professionals now live and work in the diaspora. I was astonished to find in the UK a very vibrant association Nigerian accountants, all who had qualified here in Nigeria. They were in fact the association of ICANN professionals who have sought and found opportunities for meaningful work in the UK. I wonder why the gates of opportunity that Britain opened to them were firmly shut in their own homeland. Two more illustrations of these negative outcomes, those of us. Our legal system was unable to bring a high-profile offender to book here in Nigeria. Indeed, one of our law courts discharged and acquitted him, saying that the charges against him were not proven. He is now serving a jail sentence offshore for exactly the same offense. Another one of these gatekeepers, having enjoyed immunity from prosecution for 8 years while he possessed the authority over his state's treasury, found another law court that awarded him an everlasting continuation of his immunity, even though he is now out of office. I wonder, has anyone reckoned the extent of damage that these failures of the system wrecked the morale of the citizens of this nation? Our sixth illustration shows that we are not about to emerge from the woods here. We hear that despite all of the available evidence, the National Assembly has received no fewer than 57 applications for new states to be created in Nigeria. What could be the real intention? Those applicants. I will go back to many more anomalies of the Nigerian situation, but I think we've said enough for our purpose today. Have we also noticed that we often try to correct these anomalies by defeating the very objectives that we set out to achieve? When the doctor or the teacher becomes frustrated with the gatekeepers in government, he withdraws his services and goes on strike. Does it ever worry us that an additional anomaly is created thereby? The victims of the action are not the perpetrators of the structural distortion. The patients who die are exactly those who cannot afford to seek medical assistance offshore. The students whose university career is prolonged are those whose parents did not have enough to send them to schools overseas. Those illustrations reveal the fact that we as a nation have far deeper distress than we may realize or acknowledge. We now have convincing evidence that we make the habit of using our own resources and structures to cripple our capacity for doing well. In another context, I've often expressed the view that Nigeria seems to have an allergy to good fortune. We seem to become uncomfortable and even to fall ill when anything good threatens to happen to us. Our ways of organizing our affairs actually depress the morale of the responsibility holders, making them see no option that is better than going on strike, or in some cases, sabotaging the institutions that they volunteer to nurture and protect. Is it possible our universities the center levels of top-level development of our elite human capacity have also fallen victim of this malady. If we, members of the university community nationwide, if we ever think that our situation is truly hopeless, it will be because we are managing to destroy our own capacity for making amends, and that will be the real tragedy of our position. Let me remind you that some of the numbers are very impressive. According to available records from the NUC, the National Bureau of Statistics, Nigeria now has anything between 101 and 110 universities. In the first five years between 2000 and 2004, the graduates coming from universities then in existence numbered 349,709. In the 2010-2011 session, our universities had a student population of 966,022. The academic faculty were 38,829 strong. In that session, the University of Magisterium and Scholarium in Nigeria had a population numbering over 1 million. Someone may say that a community of 1 million, a national population of over 160 million, is not particularly significant. That would be to miss the point. The members of the community of teachers and scholars belong in that community not because of their large numbers. They are there precisely because their voluntary mission is to apply their expertise and resources to the development of top quality human capacity for the nation. They are like the proverbial salt of the earth and light of the world. We do not need either salt or light in huge quantities before they can be effective. Indeed, a pinch of salt will go a long way in flavoring the sauce, because salt has properties that are effective in small doses. The point is that the effectiveness of salt depends on two important factors. The salt must influence its situation by sharing its properties with the environment. Secondly, it must avoid any attempt by the environment to overwhelm its salt flavor with some inferior substitute. The other useful application of salt, incidentally, is its use as a preservative, employing its properties to prevent decay in items of food that might otherwise go bad. Salt literally stops the rot and ensures the sustained wholesomeness of the matter to which it is applied. This analogy is certainly not too much for us to expect. But the communities of teachers and scholars in our universities represent our foremost hope for restoring our larger national community to the place of quality and excellence that it once had the potential to be. Given all that we know, why would we be justified in entertaining this hope? Students graduate from university because, among other things, it is supposed that they have satisfied the university, that they are fit, both in character and learning, to be released into the world. Learning in this context needs to be taken not as a process that has ended, as one that the learner may now use to pursue outside the walls of the institution without necessarily having to seek direction from his erstwhile instructors. In fact, what the university does for the graduate is to empower him to drive himself in the desired direction, to continue to probe the dimensions of knowledge that constitute the opportunity for helping to improve the situations that he may encounter. This provides the reason why we place so much hope on the potential of our universities to facilitate the positive development of our society. It is one of the reasons, for instance, why the managers of business corporations go to universities every year to interact with degree-year students and try to recruit the best human resource potential for their organizations. These students about to graduate are usually looking for opportunities to use that which they have acquired at university to operate whatever responsibility will be offered to them in the business world. Presumably, they enter the gate of learning opportunity at university some 4 years or so before now, and they are taking full advantage of that opportunity. The important question to ask at this point is, has the outcome measured up to the expectation that the graduate was now trying to satisfy? You know, these days it is not unusual to hear or read comments of employers and others who bemoan the allegedly low quality of the human material that comes to them from the confines of tertiary institutions. It would seem that a number of corporations soon discover that they must offer their graduate recruits additional or even remedial learning experience before they can be considered fit for even the most elementary responsibility in the firm. In other words, the firm may be eager to open the gate to the employment opportunity, but the candidate is not quite fit to walk through to meaningful activity. From all appearances, the gap between expectation and performance seems to be in the candidate's ability to study a new situation and generate useful ideas for dealing with the issues that arise from such study. It seems also that the new recruit often has considerable difficulty in expressing himself, both orally and in writing, in the language of routine interaction. These are the very attributes that the employer expects to find in a university graduate. And the frustration is heightened when the reality disappoints the expectation. Now, it is probably impertinent for me to indicate the causes of this undesirable trend, but I take refuge in a thought once expressed by Albert Einstein, who said, and I quote, "It is nothing short of a miracle that modern methods of instruction have not yet entirely strangled the holy curiosity of inquiry." In my view, learning at university should not become so structured that it constrains the freedom that curiosity must enjoy. We obviously need methods of teaching that facilitate the exercise of curiosity. Through experimentation and the questioning of the status quo, such an approach will help us to turn out graduates who will consider it their obligation continuously to find ways of adding something of real value to that which they receive at university, not by mere speculation, but by the application of intelligent curiosity. The mind of the student should be set free at every opportunity and encouraged to examine a wide range of possibilities, however far-fetched they may at first appear. Now, if we accept, we must question what is said to be a growing tendency to impart knowledge to students by means of handouts from teachers who allegedly, make some extra income from such practice. A student whose learning is constrained and circumscribed by his teacher's handout cannot from that experience easily extend, expand, or transform that which he has been given. The philosophy in the past was that the student should be encouraged to seek out and go after sources of information that will strengthen his own capacity for adding value to the adventure of learning. Lifelong education feeds on the constant updating of knowledge through learning. And the university should give priority consideration to prepare students for post-university learning, guiding them to adopt the practice of what Einstein calls holding curiosity. This is still perhaps the best way of holding the gate of opportunity open for the university graduate, through which he will grow his capacity for extending the frontiers of his own knowledge and helping to transform his society. Transformation is a word that has come into frequent use in recent days. Like many current concepts, the rhetoric can be very impressive without signifying any real understanding of what it takes to transform a society. Our confidence should be strong if we can get our research colleagues and social scientists to direct greater attention to this area of study. We must often wonder at the fact that, for instance, we have agreed that corruption is a huge problem. It's a menace to the happy future of our nation. Yet there is very little evidence that academia has produced any credible study of the issue, or have we discovered ways of overcoming it. Similarly, a number of universities have programs in political science. These programs have been duly accredited by the NUC. Can there be a way of producing studies that will help to bring some sanity to political practice in Nigeria? I would now like to return to the issue of possessors at the gate, which is actually the theme of this paper. Why is it that many keepers of the gates to opportunity perform so poorly and make things so difficult for those whose access to opportunity they should facilitate? I find that one important reason is that many holders of responsibility take possession without having ownership. For example, when a man secures a position of responsibility for which he knows he is not really qualified already, he may choose one of two ways of behaving. As a mere possessor, he will look for the opportunities to acquire as much of the benefits of the position for himself as he can take in as short a time as possible. The work expected of the role may not get done, but the expenditure will be incurred and the money will be spent. Although his name will be recorded as having held the position for a period, there will be no tangible value to show for the time and resources expended. If, however, this position holder wants to take ownership of the responsibility, he will first make every necessary effort to have a clear understanding of the role he has to play and the value that is expected from him. He will spend the time needed to achieve his clarity, working extra hours if necessary. Among other things, he will ensure that he understands the relationship between the resources that he uses and the results that he achieves. He will not merely follow the instructions that he's given. He will try to know why and how he can bring some initiative into following those instructions with creativity. He will be constantly seeking ways to develop or grow the assets that he plans. He will not miss any opportunity to improve his productivity and that of the people for whom he is responsible. He will be recognized as an apostle of best practice. In other words, the man who takes ownership of his responsibility develops a real commitment to it and always tries to work to the highest standards and with consistently good discipline. He believes that we must keep faith with the stakeholders of the endeavor. The possessor does not think of values, standards, or discipline. He thinks only of the quick benefits realizable in the immediate or short term. He has no real commitment, since he is not interested in building a worthy legacy. For him, there is only one preeminent stakeholder of the endeavor, himself. We referred earlier to some of the undesirable outcomes that flow from the activities of possessors and leaders. Clearly, if we are going to improve the situation, we need to bring as many possessors as possible into ownership of their responsibilities. We need to do this in a way that persuades today's possessors that it is in their own best interest to make the change. One of the benefits that we have is the fact that we do not have to invent a new society. We only need to restore the values and practices that once made us a respectable and self-respecting people. Can we succeed in this matter? Our best hope lies in our ability to rediscover good leadership at all levels of responsibility in Nigeria. And I use the word rediscover because we know that we have had good leaders in the past, whether in politics, education, medicine, religion, or other sectors of society. We know that we have survived thus far because of the labor of our heroes' past. If indeed that labor is not to be in vain, we have a duty to work our way back to the values and practices that informed leadership at all levels before and during our First Republic. First, we must agree that anyone who seeks a leadership role ought to be fit for it. The best way to determine fitness is to agree the criteria that we should apply. After all, we see that Almighty God doesn't appoint people to leadership in the family until they attain a certain level of maturity. People do not become fathers or mothers until they have learned how to succeed as older brothers and sisters. With this in our frame of reference, I would suggest that leaders at any level should establish their fitness through four main considerations. First, there should be a pre-qualification. The candidate should have had some experience and should be able to show a verifiable track record of good performance in roles of identifiable responsibility. Second, leaders need competence, courage, the right values, respectable standards, discipline, and stamina that will sustain them in their role. Third, we should look at results. Aspiring leaders should have produced some results in the past of a respectable quality that